pitched and straight. So after in the stance position, we lead with the head and shoulder towards the line of the ball. In this case, for a straight drive, probably the ball on middle and off stump. We leave the head and shoulder towards the line of the ball, the front foot going to the pitch of the ball, and then coming through with the bat nice and straight down the wicket and hopefully past the bowler for four. There's nothing better than when the bowler delivers the ball and you hit the ball straight back past him and he tries to grovel on the floor to stop the ball and misses it and it goes for four. Just send a little signal out to the bowler, get back to your mark and bowl the next one. Right, the on drive, boys. It's a shot, as you know, played to an overpitched ball around about the leg stump. After the stance position, the ball is coming down around about the leg stump. You want to hit it through mid-on, as I've said. Take a shorter step with your head and shoulder leading towards the ball, driving the ball through mid-on, keeping a nice face of the bat going through the line of the ball, and finishing in a check drive position. One of the most difficult shots to play in the game of cricket. A shot played to a short ball, shorter than a good length, not lifting your head so the ball goes in the air, which would give a chance of caught at mid-wicket or at mid-on or somewhere in the deep, and to keep the ball down. From the stance position, we're looking for the ball. It's short, moving the back foot across to off stump approximately, bringing the front foot round, keeping the head in line with the ball, bringing the bat down, rolling the wrist to keep it down, and following the ball round with your head down. What sort of delivery is a square cut played to?
Short, outside the off stump.
Yep, that's right. Short ball outside the off stump. The ball which is wide outside the off stump, you can use your arms to get through the ball and over the ball and hit the ball in the area of square cover or just behind. So from the stance position, eyes firmly level, move your back foot across to off stump, watching the ball onto the bat and hitting down over the bat, rolling the wrist to keep the ball down and hopefully delivering the ball just backward of square cover.
If you would like more information about coaching in your area, then phone the NCA on 0800 214 314. And good luck in your search for that perfect off drive, wherever you want to play it. Edgbaston here is one of the finest county grounds in the land, with its extensive amenities and including the spanking new Wyatt Stand. But don't think you have to live in the Big Smoke to enjoy proper cricket. There are the 18 first-class counties, but also 20 minor counties, and this year is the centenary of minor counties cricket. We sent Ralph Dellor to a suitably historic venue to find out just what goes on.
Back in 1643, these fields were the stage for one of the bloodiest battles ever seen on English soil. During the Civil War, the First Battle of Newbury ended with 6,000 dead, including the second Viscount Falkland, and the ground where we are today is known as Falkland Cricket Club. Today's engagement sees Berkshire taking on Cambridgeshire in the quarterfinals of the MCC Trophy. That's the Minor Counties knockout competition. So let's find out more about Minor Counties cricket.
There are two divisions, Eastern and Western, each containing 10 counties.
We play 9 two-day games, mainly on Sundays and Mondays, with 2 innings per side.
The two divisional winners meet at the end of the season for a two-day final to determine the overall minor counties champions.
Most of us are amateurs. There are some professionals who are often ex-county players, and they're always paid on a match-to-match basis.
So now we know something about the structure of minor counties cricket. Let's see what's happening in this match. It's 55 overs a side, and Cambridgeshire are batting.
Did I get it?
Cambridgeshire 260 for 7 in their 55 overs. But it was at that point the rains came down. An army of helpers manned the covers. And while they got soaked, we had the opportunity to ask the Berkshire captain, Mark Simmons, what he enjoys about minor counties cricket.
It's a game that I've been playing now for nearly 20 years. And I've been involved with Berkshire all that time, and I thoroughly enjoy it myself. I think if it's played in the right way, two-day cricket can be very enjoyable. I think the fact that so many guys actually play their minor counties cricket and enjoy it is indicative of what can be achieved.
The rain eventually eased up, but not before the ground was waterlogged. The original match was sadly abandoned, and we had the rare and dreaded bowl out. The sides nominate five bowlers who, after a soggy practice, will have two deliveries each. And all they've got to do is hit the stumps, like this. So here we go, the first ball. And Simon Miles for Berkshire misses. And that's the first success. Brad Donnellan for Cambridgeshire makes it 1-0. That's a good one. So 2-0 to Cambridgeshire. Standing start. But it's successful. That's a good one. 3-1 Cambridgeshire. And doesn't make any mistake at all. Now, if this one misses, Berkshire are out. And David Hartley does miss. Cambridgeshire now just one match away from a Lord's final. And what a thrill that would be for what are essentially amateur players. The standard at minor county level is good, and it reminds us that cricket in this country isn't just about the 18 first-class counties. And I tell you one thing, if you go along to your local minor county, you'll get a tremendous welcome.
And all good fortune to whichever minor counties teams eventually make it to Lords. But before that, the game's headquarters hosts this Saturday's Benson Hedges Cup final. It's a classic North v South encounter, as two of the one-day game's traditional powerhouses, Kent and Lancashire, meet in a match that will rekindle a cricketing family rivalry dating back a quarter of a century.
He's gone for a bigger hit, and that's it, and he's pulled it mid-off. It's all over, and Lancashire have won by 24 runs. And just look at these scenes.
Jack Bond's catch, when Kent were winning the game, Asif batting beautifully, and then he just made that false move. I don't think he hit that too well, it's just a thick outside edge, but Jack Bond's a little guy, he's an extra cover. But I was stood behind him, just as if he was motionless in the air, and he just stuck his right hand out, and I'd set off to run for the ball. And it stuck in there, down he went like a sack of potatoes, then threw the ball up there, and everybody on the ground knew that that had just changed the game.
And that's edged away, no slip, snicked away by Alan Knott, that's the winning run.
Clive Lloyd had got the highest score actually of the match. He was on 25, and he turned for a second run, and I was fortunate enough to come in on the boundary and let it go to the bowler's end on the first bounce, and we managed to get him run out. But it was, even though it was a low scoring final, it was a tremendous game of cricket.
The 70s, great years for both clubs, and here we are at Canterbury in front of the new stand, named after a player who used to play a little bit down here at Canterbury, where we're absolutely poised for success. We haven't won anything since 1978, where we won that Benson Hedges Cup final under the leadership of Alan Elam. His son, Mark, remembers that final very, very well, but for different reasons.
I do recall at that occasion being at my dad's sister's house on a farm, which is not too far away. And I remember being ushered into the lounge, say, come on, look, quick, Kent look like they're going to win the game, you know, Dad's going to lift the cup up sort of thing. I remember sitting down and not really taking too much interest, and all of a sudden the telly going off, and we had a power cut, which was a bit bit unfortunate. So straight away, my auntie got the radio, battery radio out, and we sat and listened to the rest of the game on there. So that's all the real memories I've got of that game.
Mark has already enjoyed great success in the Benson Hedges this year, winning the Gold Award in the quarter-final and the semi-final.
I was always involved with the game, obviously, being at cricket with Dad, bashing a tennis ball about at a young age. I did have a word with Dad one day and say, look, do you think I can give cricket a go instead of concentrating on getting a job or something? And ever since then, thankfully, things have gone quite well for me.
It's not just his batting and bowling, but his superb fielding. And where better than under the lime tree, inside the boundary ropes, in Elam territory, down here at third man, where Alan once became one of the great outfielders of all time. Mark is now following in his footsteps. There's a great father and son combination also at Lancashire with David and Graham Lloyd.
Same as Mark with Alan, I would have thought that Graham got dragged along just to watch the game and used to sit and watch and then try and mimic and get hold of the game in that way with minimal coaching, if you like, natural talent. And so it's a nice for them to come in, but you understand that they're just one of the players, nothing more. I feel every ball, a 55 over game, I can assure you, I'll feel every ball, and I call them my lads, they're all my lads, and I feel for them, and I hope things go well on the day.
Good one day teams really now have got to field well, run between the wickets well, ball accurately at the end, you know, by using yorkers and slow balls, and have players who can win games, you know, proven match winners, which we've got here and Kent have got down there, so it's got the makings of a good game.
It'll obviously be a full house. The people who watch the game on television and at the game itself will say that it's been a brilliant day and I love cricket and I'll come again. Given the right facilities and the right surface and the right day, it should be like that because they're two cracking sides.
And you can see highlights of the B&H Cup final on Saturday on BBC Two at 8:30. Sadly, the team news in advance of the game is not too good. Kent's captain Mark Benson is out having broken a finger. Steve Marsh will deputise as skipper. Lancashire will be without their England bowler, Peter Martin, who tore ankle ligaments playing for them on Sunday. He'll also be out of the next test into the bargain. And Jason Gallion's broken finger, sustained in the third test, means that he too is out of the Lancashire side on Saturday. So now let's pick up on the rest of the news from Simon Hughes.
An inflammatory article in Wisden Cricket Monthly suggesting England players born abroad are likely to be less committed to the team than those reared at home caused a rumpus, column inches and a sheepish apology from the editor. By midday last Thursday, England were already under the cosh as Mike Watkinson, not required by his country, was arriving back at Old Trafford to captain Lancashire. The match against Northants had already begun as he hurriedly got changed, but he needn't have worried. John Crawley was busy taming the Northants attack for a large 100, hustling Lancashire to a significant victory over the Championship leaders. Another popular return was Tim Munton's to Edgbaston. Injury had deprived Warwickshire of his unwavering patience and stamina, but his recovery breathed new life into the county's attempts to retain the Britannic Assurance Championship, and they've sneaked into joint top position with Northants. Watch out for the heavyweights lurking in third and fourth position, but don't get too excited about Surrey's prospects. The team with 15 championship titles are propping up the lot in the year of their 150th anniversary. Glamorgan have been in existence half that time, but have blazed an irresistible trail in the Sunday League until an unexpected last ball hiccup against Durham, needing two runs to win off the final ball.
Hits the pad. Oh, he misses, and he's overthrown it. And Glamorgan have lost it. And Glamorgan have lost the match. Durham have won it.
Well, that little skirmish could eventually affect the AXA Equity and Law League, but Glamorgan are still hanging on to top position, just clear of Kent and Worcester's booming bats, and Lancashire with a game in hand. Positive English stroke play in the under-19 one-day internationals from Centurions Marcus Truscothick and Tony McGrath made the South Africans' bowling look distinctly ordinary, and they won the series 2-0. Nice to see England batsmen making blows rather than taking them.
So there we are, and once again I hope you've enjoyed our offerings on Gower's Cricket Monthly. There's plenty of cricket left in the Test series. Three Test matches against the West Indies still to come on BBC television. But first, tomorrow, we go to Chelmsford, live for the second round of the Nat West Trophy, starting at 10:25 and Essex will be taking on Yorkshire. We're back again with the Cricket Monthly on August the 8th. I look forward to seeing you then, but for now, it's goodbye.